定上市合併，
勉強結合激化衝突，
還是澳喂最大嘛？
大股都係我哋嘅，
係我哋救你哋。
你哋越嚟越好，越嚟越產國際。
換兜暗箭，睇上台面，
有人犯咗法。
你哋根本就係有預謀、有組織。
蔡興劇《溏心風雲三》晚9:30，翡翠台。
And a preview of the new smart ID cards, complete with all the high-tech bells and whistles. Hello, good evening. North Korea has launched a powerful new intercontinental ballistic missile, it says is capable of reaching all of the U.S. mainland. The test, the first in 2.5 months, was met with international outrage and calls for more pressure to be applied on Pyongyang.Alan Bookney reports.
The test was trumpeted on North Korea state media. It said the new Hwasong-15 missile reached an altitude of about 4,500 kilometers and flew 950 kilometers during its 53-minute flight. In a statement, North Korean leader Kim Jong-un declared the country a responsible nuclear power. He said the strategic weapons were developed to defend itself from U.S. imperialists' nuclear blackmail policy and nuclear threat. Japanese Prime Minister Shinzo Abe said the missile landed in Japan's exclusive economic zone in the Sea of Japan. He called for an emergency meeting of the U.N. Security Council. 6 minutes after the launch was detected, South Korea conducted a precision strike drill, firing 3 missiles into the sea off the country's east coast. South Korean President Moon Jae-in said the test heightens tensions not only on the Korean Peninsula, but seriously threatens the peace and security of the international community. He again urged the North to restart dialogue. He also had a phone conversation with U.S. President Donald Trump, in which they agreed to respond sternly to Pyongyang's provocations while cooperating closely with the international community. This latest test comes a week after Trump put North Korea back on a U.S. list of state sponsors of terrorism.
As you probably have heard, and some of you have reported, a missile was launched a little while ago from Korea.
It's unclear how heavy a payload the missile was carrying, or if it could carry a large nuclear warhead that far. Alan Bookney, BB News.
Pope Francis has called on the people of Myanmar to embrace peace and reconciliation as the country emerges from nearly 5 decades of military rule still driven by ethnic conflicts. The pontiff continued to refrain from using the term Rohingya, for fear that it could set off a diplomatic incident and turn the military against minority Christians. Jeff Tang reports.
Barely more than 1% of Myanmar's 51 million people are Roman Catholic, but that's still 700,000 people, enough to fill up Wembley Stadium nearly 8 times. Local authorities estimate some 150,000 of them traveled to the former capital, Yangon, today to attend mass on the grounds of what used to be a racecourse during British colonial times. Some pilgrims traveled all the way from Australia to see the Pope.
Very important, we're so excited. This is once in a lifetime event. So happy.
When the Pope finally appeared, he preached a message of forgiveness in his first mass in the predominantly Buddhist nation. He urged the country's long-suffering ethnic minorities to resist the temptation to exact revenge for the hurts they have endured. But like he had done the day before, he refrained from mentioning the Rohingya by name, a move that was slammed by international human rights groups. Yesterday, Francis told Myanmar leader Aung San Suu Kyi in his keynote speech that the country's future lay in respecting the rights of all its people. However, a leading rights activist in Myanmar said the blame should lie with the Pope's advisers. They were said to have urged Francis not to use the word Rohingya in Myanmar, out of fear that it could turn the country's military against minority Christians. In Myanmar, Rohingya are recognized as citizens or as members of a distinct ethnic group. More than 620,000 of them have fled from Rakhine State to the southern tip of Bangladesh since the end of August, in Asia's worst refugee crisis in decades. That's after the Myanmar military launched a crackdown in response to Rohingya militant attacks on an army base and police security posts. Scores of Rohingya villages were burnt to the ground, and refugees told of killings and rapes. The crackdown, which has been described by Western powers as ethnic cleansing, has drawn international condemnation. Jeff Tang, TVB News.
Indonesian authorities have reopened the airport in Bali 2 days after a volcanic eruption spread ash across parts around the holiday island. Authorities had originally wanted to shut the Denpasar International Airport until at least 7 a.m. tomorrow, but reversed their decision. They downgraded the warning to orange, one level below the most serious, after reviewing weather conditions. Yesterday, all three major Hong Kong airlines announced the cancellation of 13 daily flights to Bali until Thursday. Indonesian President Joko Widodo implored residents living in the danger zone around Mount Agung to immediately seek refuge in emergency centers. Fearing for a larger eruption, authorities are hastening their evacuation efforts in nearby villages. And back in Hong Kong, the government has revealed the new Hong Kong Smart ID card design. It comes with 9 state-of-the-art security features, and some 8.8 million existing cards will be replaced, starting from the fourth quarter of next year. Anne Morrison has details.
The Hong Kong Smart Identity Card is getting a facelift. In papers submitted to the Legislative Council today, the Security Bureau outlined the new design, which comes with 9 state-of-the-art security features to prevent forgeries. The new ID card will be pink, light blue, and light green in colour. The holder's photo will be on the left. Next to the photo will be a hologram with wave and 3D effect. And below it, a tactile leaf. At the top right, there's a see-through window partially showing the card number. And in the far right corner, the words Hong Kong embossed in tactile relief. The card will have a multi-pattern background. There's also a stereo laser image or SLI of the photo at the bottom right. The data chip is placed at the back of the card instead of the front, and the arrow will use optically variable ink. The card also uses rainbow printing. The government has proposed including a digital photograph and the bearer's gender in the chip, in addition to the currently stored ID card number, English name, Chinese name, date of birth, and date of issue. The paper noted that this would allow flexibility for financial institutions to assess the costs and benefits of adopting technology more widely to provide secure and efficient services, such as facial recognition. It also said that adding the gender would eliminate the current need for healthcare providers to manually input that information. The government will start a card replacement program for all residents in the fourth quarter of next year. It'll involve some 8.8 million ID cards and cost $1.46 billion until the exercise ends in 2022. The Immigration Department will set up 9 card replacement centres across the city. In May 2015, LegCo's Finance Committee approved the funding to implement the project. Last time the cards were replaced was in 2003, and that involved 6.8 million residents. Anne-Marie Sim, TVB News.
Police say 2 15-year-olds were victims in a phone scam involving a total of $110,000. Officers arrested a 21-year-old woman in connection with both cases. She is believed to have wired some of the money collected to mainland bank accounts. Police said the two teenagers received calls from people claiming to be mainland authorities. They were accused of money laundering and ordered to pay up. The students apparently got their hands on the money by taking cash and jewelry from their homes. And the tug of war on opening up the market for pre-booked car services continues. Transport Chief Frank Chan said the government does not object to e-hailing, but one scholar insists the Consumer Council's proposal just won't work.
Those who've had difficulties flagging a taxi on the streets may have ordered a ride through a mobile app. That pre-booked market is one the Consumer Council suggested to open up at their press conference yesterday. Their reasons? Create a level playing field for different services to compete, increase consumers' choices, and improve service quality. The government is not opposed to e-hailing, said Ministry for Transport and Housing Frank Chen. Though we need to thoroughly consider how it should be conducted, public reception, and effect on traffic flow. But did not say how authorities will study the issue. The consumer watchdog proposed regulating e-hailing services. For example, service providers should conduct background security checks on drivers. Vehicles used must not be older than 7 years and drivers be in good health and meet required language skills. It was suggested that those who meet those requirements can apply for higher car permits from the government, currently capped at 1,500. Even so, a scholar with links to the local taxi trade thinks this number just won't be enough to meet demand. He also raised another problem.
They said that the taxi are free to join, but then they impose another condition on the taxi. Basically say that the taxi has to charge according to the meter. This is discriminative to the taxi, because if the taxi free to join the scheme, every participant joining the scheme should have the same condition.
But he agrees on the need to regulate e-hailing services. This evening, some of the city's most influential figures paid their respects to the late Mona Fong. Former chief executives Tung Chee Hwa and Donald Zong attended tonight's wake at Hong Kong Funeral Home in North Point. Notables from the business and entertainment sectors were also present. Mona Fong passed away last week at the age of 83. She was TVB's non-executive director and married to the station's founder, Sir Rung Run Shaw. The company will hold a memorial service for Fong next month. The Link REIT has agreed to sell 17 shopping centres in the city to a private consortium. However, lawmakers fear the plan will adversely affect residents of public housing estates. Sharon Tang reports.
The deal involves $23 billion worth of property, including Kwai Fong Plaza, Kwai Shing East Shopping Centre, Kwai Chung Shek Lei Shopping Centre, and properties previously owned by the Housing Authority. However, some LegCo members are worried about the thousands of public housing estate residents who could be impacted.
We are very concerned about the Link's action this time. By selling these properties, we are afraid that the grassroots residents living in those public housing estates cannot get their basic necessities as required by the housing ordinance.
She urged the government to set up a committee with high-level departmental officials so that the new developer fulfills the requirements in the ordinance. This resident living in Kwai Chung Estate doubts the elderly in the area could cope with any rising costs. They may need to go further to buy cheaper food and daily life necessities.
Once the government has privatized all the public housing retail space, then we will witness the current situation that rent in all those rate shopping mall will rise on, and then there will be they will again sold out these shopping malls when it's good for them.
Chu believes the government should build a public market in addition to creating more retail space in housing estates to balance the privately owned shopping malls. Sharon Tang, TVB News.
The Tourism Board will launch a new version of its Symphony of Light show on December 1st. The 10-minute multimedia show will light up the iconic Victoria Harbour every evening at 8. It will incorporate new lighting effects, including coloured searchlights, laser and beam lights sent out in rhythm from more than 40 buildings and sites on both sides of the harbour. And for the first time, the show will feature LED panels on several harbourside buildings displaying interactive audience participation. The light show will be complemented by a new musical score performed by the Hong Kong Philharmonic Orchestra. And in the NBA, the Cleveland Cavaliers continue their hot run, beating the Miami Heat. The Cavs have now won 9 straight. Here's Jameson Watt.
Lots of love early in Cleveland. Kevin Love exploded for 22 points in the first quarter against the Miami Heat. Love had 32 for the half as the Cavaliers led 75-49 at the break. LeBron James scored 21 points to go along with 12 rebounds. King, though, in the third quarter was ejected for the first time in his career, more than 1,000 games worth, after he didn't get the foul call.
LeBron James has just been...
Nonetheless, the Cavs rolled to their ninth straight win, 108-97 the final. Love finished with 38. Jameson Wall, TVB News.
Golf and Tiger Woods says he's not sure what to expect from his latest comeback. This week, the former world number one will play in his first tournament in almost a year, Hero World Challenge in the Bahamas.
Let me play this event and see what I can and can't do. I'll have a better understanding once I'm in game speed. I know I've always hit harder come game time because adrenaline, and I'm looking forward to it, and I'm also looking forward to see how I feel. I miss playing golf for fun. Go out there and hit and giggle and play for some denominations and have a good time. I had done that in 2 years. I played 9 holes here and 18 holes here, and then I had to take 3 days off because my back was killing me. I hadn't been able to play fun golf like that with my friends in such a long time.
Buckingham Palace has announced that Prince Harry and Meghan Markle will have a spring wedding at Windsor Castle. Royal officials have been thrilled with the response to the couple's engagement and positive reaction to Monday's TV appearance. The wedding will be in May, but an exact date hasn't been chosen. The ceremony will be held at St. George's Chapel, the historic chapel on the grounds of Windsor Castle. And a quick check of the weather before we go. Mainly fine. Expect a high temperature on Thursday of about 25 degrees. And that's the news. Thanks for watching. Good night.